Before we get back into custom building, we want to give Andrew and Modern Outfitters a little shout out. The town of Little Elm, Texas, lost an officer in the line of duty earlier this year, and that police department's only sniper rifle had to be taken as evidence. Modern Outfitters put together a Remington 700 Custom that was a pretty significant upgrade from the one that they had to be confiscated. The Remington was then donated to the Little Elm PD so that the grieving department didn't have to go without a sniper rifle. So with that, I say thank you very much, Andrew. I think that was freaking awesome. I think a lot of people underestimate the resources that a lot of police departments have around not only here, but I mean across the country. And so just to be able to be in a position to do something like that, I'm pretty sure it felt pretty good.
It did. Yeah. We're glad to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. So I took some flack online for going from, I mean, I didn't go from 308 to 6.5 Creedmoor. I just had, let's talk about the conversation. Because remember you and I had, I remember very specifically having a conversation with you about determining whether or not I wanted to do 308 or 6.5 Creedmoor. Initially, I was kind of, maybe I'll do it in 308. And I think largely just because it was in my comfort zone. I was used to having rifles chambered in 308 when I was looking at something of this platform. And so then we got to talking and talked about the 6.5 Creedmoor a little bit more. Now in the video, just to be honest, I did make it seem like the only reason I went with the 6.5 Creedmoor is because I just thought it was cool or it sounded cool. Really, it was basically me kind of tongue in cheek saying, you know, why would you say you have a 308 when you can say you have a 6.5 Creedmoor? But with that being said, why would somebody want to go with the 6.5 over the 308? Not insinuating the 308 is a horrible round or if there's something wrong with the 308, but what are some of the benefits and drawbacks that I'm going to have going with the 6.5 Creedmoor versus the 308?
So like anything, we always ask customers, what's your application? What are you going to be doing with this rifle? So whenever you and I had the conversation, you really wanted to get into long-range target mm-hmm. shooting. Okay. So if you had said, hey, I want a hunting rifle, we probably would have had a different conversation, although the 6.5 is a very capable hunting rifle. The 6.5 Creedmoor, so pros and cons, and guys have opinions. So like you said, there's nothing wrong with the 308. I love the 308. I got a bunch of 308s. I shoot 308 all the time. The 6.5 is unique primarily in the projectile shape and the fact that essentially you're getting 300 Win Mag type performance without the recoil, okay? And so if you were telling me you were shooting 500 yards was your max, then there's not a lot of difference. You're kind of splitting hairs between the 308 and the 6.5 Creedmoor. Once you get past 500, and let's even call it 700 to 1,000, the Creedmoor and a lot of 6mm variants, the guys are shooting PRS and other matches, has an advantage because of the couple of things. It's less susceptible to wind drift. The shape of the projectile enables you to make more consistent shots at longer range. And the misnomer is that the 6.5 Creedmoor is some screaming hot round and you're not having to hold. I'm out on all that. So we're dialing or we're holding. So really, to some degree, doesn't matter how fast it is. If you were, all right, I want a super fast rifle so that from 0 to 300 I'm not having to do a lot of holding, that's, again, a different conversation.
Yeah.
But in a nutshell, the Creedmoor allows you, and I say it in here, I think it's cheating. once you get past 500 yards and I've sat down on the bench, especially when it's windy, I can make shots on 12-inch steel at 1,000 yards much more consistently with the 6.5 Creedmoor than I can with the 308.
Gotcha. And I got to be honest that to a degree, I'm a little insulted. Because I think a lot of people just saw the bolt gun and thought, okay, he's never going to shoot this thing past 500 yards, so why in the hell would he go with a 6.5 Creedmoor? And I'm like, so what? I'm not capable of shooting out to 1,000? I mean, I did kind of do it in Buck Doyle's course with a 5.56, but hey, I'm not going to toot my own horn. But, it was interesting kind of seeing the comments. And you know, I've done a couple of videos where I talked about caliber choices, whether it be 9mm 40 or 45. What I know a lot of people didn't realize is, you know, like people are just as ardent about their choices in rifle calibers as well as they are about pistol calibers. And so it was kind of a culture shock in many ways, because I knew people were kind of crazy about their pistol rounds. I didn't realize it was to that degree when it came to rifle rounds, especially when we're talking about 308s and other calibers. So right. From that perspective, it was definitely an eye opener. But at the same time, I have a couple of 308 bolt action rifles, and initially my only purpose was, you know, I wanted to do another one because it was my comfort zone, so to speak. And I wasn't completely and thoroughly versed in the 6.5 Creedmoor, at least when I walked in the door that day, compared to where I am now. And so thus far, I don't have any regrets. Now, with respect to ammo availability, pricing, what is that going to look like?
So ammo availability is, if you'd asked me a year or even a year and a half ago, the 308 would be the hands down winner. And 308 is still going to be available at every gas station, at every small Walmart or anything. So if guys are saying, oh, I want to be able to get hunting ammo no matter where I'm at in the country, 308 is going to have the advantage. But Creedmoor has come on. There's so many more companies loading for it now. Price-wise, it's a push. So if you're talking premium target rounds, whether it's like a Federal Match or a Hornady ELD, there is no difference in price. It's essentially the same price regardless on what caliber. The same thing with premium hunting ammo. I can find cheap 308 plinking ammo, but with what you're doing, that's not what you're shooting anyway. You're shooting good match ammo, so that comparison really, that argument doesn't hold water.
Yeah, it's not like me taking my AR out there and just running through 200, 300 rounds in 15 minutes. Because I've done that before.
I've been there when you've done it.
Now I want to talk about, let's talk about this 60-degree bolt throw, right? Okay. You and I kind of talked about it a little bit with respect to the way to, you know, for someone who's used to your kind of standard bolt, you're going to kind of try to run it the same way on this particular bolt gun, which is what you've told me is not the smartest thing to do.
Yeah, so there's a couple of things there. One, the action is titanium, and titanium has a different feel than steel on steel. So that's where coatings come in to make sure your raceway is slick and you have that same smooth feel. The MR1 is a straight push-pull action. That's how we designed it. So one, what we know some guys, as they're getting used to it, one, the bolt throw. So you're not coming up, and if you've run a Remington 700 for your entire life, a lot of guys are coming up too hard or they're going to be torquing the action. Yeah. But once you get used to it, where it's that short throw and it's almost in one movement. It's not quite like a Blauser, but it's close. It's a hybrid. So you're coming up short, pulling back and running the gun forward. And once you get used to the MR1, as you run it forward, the bolt almost goes down on its own. It's very natural feel closing the bolt.
Yeah. Cause I know initially for me, I know I was overcranking it. I can almost assure you I was overcranking it. And, you know, once I actually started running a little bit more and started letting the bolt do what it does on its own in many ways, I really didn't have much of a problem in that regard. So there is it's not so substantial that I would call it a learning curve, kind of like a little, you know, just a shift in the way that you handle the bolt compared to more traditional style rifles. So now with, you guys have the MC7 coming out. Is there anything on the horizon that you want to talk about in terms of recent releases? Anything new you guys are doing at the shop?
Yeah, we designed our own chassis. So we did the 3D printed version last week. So we designed our own. It's a Remington 700 footprint. So you ought to see that here probably in the next month or so. We'll start doing a few out of aluminum. Mm-hmm. But that's a chassis that we'll sell separately as well as put in on our next round of MR1s and bolt guns. We put in a new, as far as on the manufacturing side, a shop here in Dallas. So we'll be able to start. We ran gas blocks last week. Went great. We'll be running the chassis here, some of the MC7 parts. So it ought to be an eventful summer with the 7 and the chassis. If you're in the long range, it'll be your summer.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Is there any, so what made you guys want to decide to build your own chassis?
Kind of the same reason we decided to build a bolt gun. Right. There's some great chassis out there. So really what we wanted is something lightweight. We wanted something that for a price point for the consumer right now to get the chassis with all what we like the features, you're talking $1,600 to $2,000.
Yeah.
It's still yet to be determined, but I think our chassis is going to be sub $1,000. We'll do our normal paint treatment to it, so the consumer will be able to buy a a custom Cerakoted painted chassis for their 700 for under $1,000. It's ready to go.
Gotcha. Any thoughts of maybe coming out with your own handguns?
We haven't played with that. That's such a crowded market. Yeah. For us. You know, we stick to what we know and what we do, what we think we do fairly well. Pistols, there's so many great options out there, and we wouldn't even know where to start. So I think for now we'll stick with customizing other people's work and go from there.
Gotcha. So now with respect to custom pistols, what tends to be your biggest seller in terms of customizing pistols? One in brand, and then what models in that particular brand?
Glock 19, hands down. So the Glock 19 is, I think people like it because it's they can conceal it. Mm-hmm. If it's not, you know, a subcompact by any means. I'm not saying it's a perfect concealed handgun, but it's small enough to where you can conceal it, but big enough to where you can still run it on the range and it's not beating you to death and you still have the accuracy. So the 19 is by far the favorite. And then as far as what people ask for, it's the usual. So it's stippling, it's machine slides, it's Cerakote, trigger work, trigger jobs, night sights, things like that.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much, Andrew, for joining us. It's always a pleasure having you on the show. Look forward to seeing that MC7 in person.
Yeah, well, on the chassis, people that are giving you hard time about the Magpul, we'll run a chassis over there in a couple of weeks and we'll see what they think about it.
All right. I'm pretty sure they'll have something to say about that too.
I'm
never at a loss for words. All right, man. Thank you very much, and you definitely have a good one.
All right, bud. See you later.
All right, man. Take care. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, an anti-gun teddy bear. Yeah.